It's the morning star drive 107.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
Hey guys, how's it going? It's Tuesday, November 15th, and this is the morning star drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. So what is happening on this wonderful Tuesday? We've got current news from around the world, the practical word study, and of course, Pravi in the media. All right, everyone, how are you doing today? Yes, it is Tuesday. Monday is officially over. Tuesday, we're getting straight into the big core and meat of the week, and hope that all of us are doing well, putting the words into action, especially with this week's message of the end is strong. So really thankful for all you guys joining us here on the Morningstar Drive. So keep liking and commenting. I want to hear from you guys and see how you're doing. Let us build the community more than anything else, all right? So Q&A Thursday, just 2 days away. Get your questions ready for this week. Q&A is one of the most popular segments every single week, and I enjoy it too. And I hope that you guys have some really, really good questions for this week also. So get them in early so I can choose the ones that are that I think everyone can benefit from, all right? So I told you the other day that I went to a Christian church on Sunday, right? It was an evening service and a pretty big church here in Malaysia, because there's only like, what, 5% Christian in Malaysia. And this church is like, it's 5%. The population of Malaysia is about the same as Canada, about 33, 34 million people around there, right? And 5% is Christian, which is means how many? So 5% of, what's 5% of 10 million? Well, 1 million 5% would be 50,000. 500. So about 1. Something million Christians, right? I went to a church yesterday called Kingdom City, and oh, not yesterday, the day before on Sunday night, and it was about a 4,000 person church. So it's really, really big. It's considered a big, it's a mega church. Like in the world, it'd be considered a mega church. They hold it inside a conference room inside a resort. Okay, so it's really, really nice. I had a friend that I met for the first time like last week, a very strong Christian, and I saw how Christian this person was during the time of praise and worship and during the entire service. So I'm going to super be honest with you. Like, I'm going to be honest, like give you a very, very honest assessment. I'm not going to be very negative. I'm just going to talk about what I really felt during that service. Okay. Number one is this. Number one is Christian churches, praise is another level. And especially these huge churches, their praise is so good. Like they have the formula down. They produce a great atmosphere of worship. The music is amazing. The level of music is great. And as I was like kind of singing these songs, it's really, it's very, what do you call it? It's perfect for this time and generation. Like, let me give an example. Mental health is a big thing that people deal with today, right? And one of the songs is about Jesus's, the lyrics are about Jesus is over anxiety, is over depression, is over like all this mental illness. So it's saying that Jesus is stronger than all these things, right? And as you sing it, if you're someone struggling with these things, it gives you that, it empowers you to have even greater faith in Christ, right? So I thought that was, the music was very, very relevant, right, to this generation. There was another song I really, really liked, and it wasn't like just Jesus, 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 but it was, I have a story. I want to confess my story of how Jesus saved me and how I was, you know, low, but then Jesus saved. You know, it's kind of one of those songs, like a song of confession, right? Kind of like my confession to the Lord, kind of one of those types of songs. It was really, really good. And I'm going to be honest with you guys. When it comes to smaller churches in Pravi, in many cases, we just use the MR, right? There's like a music playing, and then you have like, you know, singers in the front, and they just sing along with the recording, right? And I'm going to be honest with you guys, like, of course, when it comes to smaller churches, it's the best you can do, right? It's true, right? It's the best you can do. However, it's not organic, right? And what does it mean, not organic? It's not natural, meaning, like, it was, like, this is praise. I was watching this church do it, and they're doing it 3 services a day and every single week, and it's very organic, natural, and raw, which means like the praise leader's singing, and then she's queuing up the praise team when to go to the next song or when she's ready to repeat. It's kind of like how Pastor Joan does it, like during these big events, right? Because you have that level of musicians. And you know, basically the praise leader's reading the atmosphere, reading the crowd. And I would say like the praise was, it was like good 30, 40 minutes. Well, it started at 5 and the message started at 6. So, and it was a half an hour message. And yeah, but it was a surprisingly, it was a 2 hour service. The message itself was 30 minutes. I thought it would be longer than 30 minutes, but the message was only 30 minutes. But when I was looking at the praise, it was so organic. It was, you had like six singers up there. You had four background dancers like doing a, like a worship dance. And yeah, it was really, I really, really enjoyed it. And they just set the mood really, really well. Of course, you know, the level is a little bit different, but I really thought the level of the music, the atmosphere, the leaders that are reading the entire audience, how the praise team were like dynamic, working together, repeating things. It was just really, really good. Right, so there's one thing I thought was amazing, but if we were to go to the sermon, I'm gonna be super transparent with you guys. I have heard many really, really good preachers in Christian churches, like really good ones. Like I'm inspired, like wow, that's a great message. Okay, and you know, of course you can't compare the word itself, but I've heard many, many good preachers. They can make a sermon just so well. And I would even say that because they're so experienced in making sermons and preaching, that they're probably better than the vast majority of Providence speakers, right? Because they've been doing all their life. And the biggest difference would be we're reading from a script while they are making their own sermons every single week, right? But I would have to say it was the youth pastor that was speaking, and I was just really, really disappointed. Like the level, like, remember, like I said, I've heard a lot of good preachers, but this person was just kind of yelling and hooping and hollering and saying, just trying to say catchphrases. Like, God is great, you know, God loves you. Trying to make catchphrases like, don't do this, but do this kind of thing. You know what I mean? And also trying way too hard to be funny. And just kind of like read something and just says anything that comes to mind. And I was really, really disappointed. I couldn't even grasp the key point he was trying to make. Like the title was, What's Your Wardrobe? And it was a story of Bartimaeus. And it's, you know, when this person was crying out to Jesus to heal him, and then, you know, disciples were telling him to shut up and stuff. And then he shouted even more. Then Jesus finally said, hey, come here. And then he healed him of his blindness, right? And it was just done in such a very, like, I guess that's why he's a youth pastor. It's just in such like, not a very mature way. Like, some guy comes out trying to get cheap laughs because this guy's supposed to be blind. And then he's taking, like, he says, what's your wardrobe? Are you wearing the wardrobe of depression, the wardrobe of, you know, like, just a bunch of different things there. And he had so much prepared, but it was, yeah, like, yeah, I'm sorry. It wasn't very good. Yeah, it wasn't very good at all. And, yeah, and even looking at, like, you know, Providence, even we're starting to do our own messages, but we have references from the Sunday messages from the past. Like, you know, this week's message and this strong, the head leaders are making these messages, but they have a reference of a message from the past, right? And it's just so much better, like so much clearer, more detailed. The explanation, the examples are so much better, right? But I'm not saying that it's all Providence, because I know that there's some churches out there where you have some amazing pastors that preach really, really well, right? And they have good content also. But when I was listening to this, it was just like, ugh. Like, how do you, like, you know, this guy's just struggling, just saying things off the top of his head. And that was something that made me so disappointed, because the level of praise compared to the sermon was so off. And I'm not saying this is all Christian churches. It's just the one that I went to this time here. And I would say overall, the praise was definitely like an A-minus. And then, like, if I were to compare it to Hillsong and Planet Shakers, you know, Hillsong, Planet Shakers, like an A+, isn't around there. This was a good A-. The sermon, I would give it a C-. And, you know, like, even after this, like, not very good sermon, they did an altar call, right, where they're calling people to come to Christ. And ugh, we spent this other pastor comes up dragging it out for like 15 minutes, just asking, like, well, it's almost like begging people to come up to be saved kind of thing. And I found that to be a little bit annoying. That's why I went for like 2 hours. But if you take that part out, like, and you know, overall, I had a good time. It was a C+, B- around there. And met some really, really good, amazing people. After I went to have dinner with everyone, and they asked me a question about Noah's flood, and I shared with them. They were just genuinely floored by it. So I was really happy about that. But overall, very, very interesting experience. And I think I'm going to go back again. And I do think it's sometimes good for us to go to these bigger Christian churches just to see what the vision could be like, right? It's almost the same as like going to Korea to see the White Stone Church. You get an idea, it's like, oh, that's what it's supposed to be like in the future when we grow to 2,000, 3,000 people, right? So when I looked at that, I was like, oh, okay, that makes a little bit more sense, right? And it's good for us to just get an idea of how far Christianity has come. So yeah, that was a very, very interesting experience, and I hope it's something that a lot of people can learn from just by checking out some churches every once in a while, right? I did that when I was in New York too. We'd go to Hillsong Church like maybe once every 2-3 months, but I thought that was very, very eventful also too to do those things. Today also we have a practical word study, so I hope, you know, I'm thankful for you guys that are putting in the comments how much this word study is actually helping you guys out and making you think more deeply about what we can do more practically with the word. So definitely we're going to be working on that a lot more, and that's going to be every single Tuesday, right? And today's Proverbs in the Media, very, very good resource today because it's going to be an article on the entire court system and trial process in Korea. And this is kind of, when you understand this, you'll get an idea of why, you know, or what Sun Seem's going to be going through starting from this Friday, right? So I think this is going to be a big benefit to a lot of us here just to know the process itself, all right? Brand new poll just came out, and I was thinking about this because I just had that experience with that spirit and ghost in my new apartment and stuff. So I put, have you ever seen ghosts, spirits, ghosts, or demons, right? And if you have, go ahead, press yes, no. Some people are unsure. They're like, maybe they saw it, but they're not sure. So I have that too. And then, you know, just go ahead and write it in there. Would love to see how many people have actually seen, like really, really seen ghosts more than anything else, like ghosts, spirits, evil spirits, Satan's demons, whatever it is. So go ahead and check that out. And I'm very much expecting a very, very small number because not many people have, you know, are able to see them. Not very many, right? So I would say that I would be surprised if it was over 20% in the end, right? All right. So let's, Espresso with Sky, remember, make sure you guys see that video is out this week from last week. And that one is my first week in Malaysia, but it's a video about giving thanks, right? And I hope that's something that you guys can really gain and benefit from also, okay? All right, so let's get this show started with some music from member artists from around the world. And who is today's featured artist of the day on this awesome Tuesday? We're going to go into the Rapture Collective from Australia. Always bringing out new stuff, and I'm very, very grateful and thankful to all those guys out there. This is the latest one that just dropped, I think a week ago, and this one is Me and My Squad. That's from the Rapture Collective from Australia. Not the full group, it's just going to be Julius and Daniel. Great song here, Me and My Squad, Rapture Collective, that's the feature artist of the day. Then we have AG from Japan with Come Down on Me, Holy Spirit, that's the EDM version. And we'll end things off with Juustar from New Zealand with Swaying.
Aha, okay.
316, don't forget it.
About to go to war with this one.
I'm ready.
I was not against flesh and blood though. But we got our swords ready, come on, let's get it. Here we go. Here we go.
Yeah, it's me and my squad.
7 strands of rope in a knot. I'm not on my own, better leave us alone. I got God, the Spirit, the Son, Jesus, the One, the angels of heaven in the block behind me. I heard them bribing their talk behind my back. Gossip is gossip. Talk is cheap, I ask them to show me. It's easy to tell, they don't even know me. Rarely saw them walking the walk, just talking the talk. I know that they're bluffing. Never mind you, I do what I do. I'm focused on the world, I ain't worried about you.
No way. Now,
we're not the same, I do what's required to pay all my dues. I'm riding the new wave, we're not on the same level, we got different views. I do things in new ways, as soon as I hear the word and get up from the pews. Yeah, I'm never the same, but my heart doesn't change. Yeah, I'm one with the Lord and I'm rapping his name. Yeah, I'll go to the end, that's the end of the game.
That's the end of the game.
Emptying out all my thoughts and putting on Christ, cause you know I've been saved. No doubt about it. If you're looking for proof, tell the world to come see me. Here in Sumny, we do things legitly. From Alpha and Omega, we do things completely.
Everyday life of faith, building strong foundation.
Spiritual gains.
Consistency, we go all the way. It's how we start and finish our day. Don't care about what they say, living out the word of truth anyway. I look to the hills where my help comes from.
It's me and my squad.
Here we go.
Yeah, it's me and my squad.
Here we go.
Yeah, it's me and my squad.
7 strands of rope in a knot. I'm not on my own, better leave us alone. I got God, the Spirit, the Son, Jesus, the One, the angels of heaven and the block behind me. Here we go.
Yeah, it's me and my squad.
Here we go.
Yeah, it's me and my squad.
7 strands of rope in a knot. I'm not on my own, better leave us alone. Try and tug and pull, you find there's no breaking me. Solid faith like a rock, no hope of shaking me.
They rambling, soon as our squad shows up, demons be scrambling. Laying down my own thoughts, I pick up my cross. No need to worry, I follow the boss.
7-7-7, never ending, winning a game like it's 7-11. Don't count us out, getting up again, never giving up. So much strength from the source, like a leaky force, there's so much drip.
Grace
was running in place, slipping on contradictions. Now I got traction, moving forward victoriously. Conviction, just stuck in since prison. Lord set me free, no more cage. Dropped all the charges, you don't wanna tussle. We move and hustle, talk is cheap, gotta walk it out. Every day, show you what we bout, something light. They rolling with sixes, we rolling on sevens. Staying on course till we reach in the heavens.
Here we go, here we go.
Yeah, it's me and my squad.
Here we go, here we go.
Yeah, it's me and my squad.
Seven strands of rope in a knot. I'm not on my own, better leave us alone. I got God, the Spirit, the Son, Jesus, the One, the angels of heaven and the block behind me.
We go until the end, unending. Won't catch us slipping, when it's game time.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit assist, ask for strength and multiplies. When spirits involved, problems resolve. New strength and resolve, no limits dissolve. You thought it was over until we called Jehovah. When my squad shows up, it's game over.
Don't cry for me. Cry for yourself.
And there is Jewstar Aiden Verity over there in New Zealand with the song Swang. That's one of my favorite songs from her. I really like the content of that. It's very relatable to me too. Before that, AG from Japan with Come Down On Me, Holy Spirit. That's the EDM version. And of course, featured artist of the day, that is Rapture Collective from Australia with Me and My Squad. All right, so as brides of this history, let's get into the current news. What is going on around the world? And it is our responsibility to pray for this world, but in order to pray for it, we need to know what is going on. So we watch the news for three reasons. One, see what we need to report and pray for. Two, see what God is doing. And three, what are the things we need to comfort God's heart in? So let's start off with what is going on with Russia and the Ukraine. And of course, we heard yesterday that Kherson was taken back from Ukraine, from Russia. Ukraine has taken it back, and now there are curfews and there's a river ban in a security crackdown. So after scenes of joy in newly liberated Kherson, the Ukrainian authorities have imposed a curfew and restricted travel in and out of the city as the security situation remains tense. There are fears that Russian troops now digging in on the opposite bank of the Dnipro River may resume shelling. Kherson officials have banned use of river transport from November 13th to 19th. Locals who fled have been warned not to return until their homes have been checked for mines or booby traps. Russian explosives litter the region. The enemy mined all critical infrastructure objects, said Kherson Governor Yaroslav Yanushevich. He has told citizens to avoid crowded places and stay away from the city center on Monday because the military will be demining there. The overnight curfew runs from 5 p.m. to 8 a.m., and officials have returned to run Kherson's administration after the retreat of some 30,000 Russian occupation troops. There are also fears that some Russian soldiers may have remained behind in disguise, while collaborators who helped the Russians during the occupation are now liable to be prosecuted. In a reminder of the continuing threat, a volley of artillery fire hit the area of Kherson Airport on Sunday. President Zelensky said the Russians had destroyed all critical infrastructure in Kherson, depriving the city of heat, electricity, water, and communications. Gradually, essential supplies are arriving in Kherson, Ukraine officials said. And Governor Yanushevich has announced a distribution of firewood to residents of Kherson and nearby areas, instructing them to request it with their ID and contact details. The city council also plans to hand out 6,000 small stoves to local residents. Kherson's liberation on Friday was marked by crowds of flag-waving Ukrainians greeting Kyiv soldiers with hugs and kisses. The celebrations continued on Saturday. Ukrainians see it as a major national victory and humiliation for the Kremlin on a par with the Russian withdrawal from the Kyiv suburbs in March. Kherson was the only regional capital to be captured by Russia since the February invasion of Ukraine. The region, along with three others, was proclaimed by President Putin to be part of Russia at a ceremony in the Kremlin in September. So that's great news, but also being very cautious is a great move for the Ukrainians right now, because I do feel also that there's going to be a lot of shelling. Let's go over to Slovenia. And great news, they had elections in Slovenia, and Slovenia elects a lawyer as first female president. Slovenia has elected a lawyer linked to former U.S. First Lady Melania Trump as its first ever female head of state. Natasa Perk-Musar is a journalist and lawyer who ran as an independent with the backing of Slovenia's center-left government. She defeated former Foreign Minister Anzi Logar, a veteran of conservative politics. Ms. Musar won almost 54% of the vote ahead of Mr. Logar, who got just over 46%, the Election Commission said. Turnout among the population of around 2 million was 49.9%, the commission said. Slovenia has elected a president who believes in the European Union, in the democratic values on which the EU was founded. And this is what Ms. Musar said after her victory. She noted that the world is facing tough times because of climate change. Young people are now putting the responsibility on our political shoulders to take care of our planet so that our next generation, our children, will live in a healthy and clean environment, she said. The role of president is mostly ceremonial, but Ms. is Musar will be commander-in-chief of the armed forces and also nominate several top officials, including the central bank governor. Ms. Musar was hired as a lawyer to protect the interests of Mrs. Trump, who was born in Slovenia during her husband's presidency. And in 2016, Ms. Musar and her client filed a lawsuit against Suzy magazine in Slovenia for suggesting Mrs. Trump had worked as a high-end escort while pursuing her international modeling career. An out-of-court settlement was reached. So big congratulations over there to Ms. Musar over there in Slovenia, the newly elected and first female president. Last but not least, let's go into Turkey. In Istanbul, 6 dead as dozens wounded in Turkey explosion. At least 6 people have been killed and 81 wounded in an explosion in a busy area of central Istanbul, Turkish authorities have said. Blast happened at around 4:20 p.m. local time on a shopping street in the Taksim Square area, the Turkish city's governor Ali Yerlikaya said. Vice President Fuat Oktay said the blast was thought to be a terrorist attack carried out by a woman. President Recep Tayyip Erdogan said the perpetrators would be punished. And speaking at a news conference in Istanbul, he condemned what he called the vile attack and said the smell of terror was in the air. Justice Minister Bekir Bozdag told Turkish media a woman had sat on a bench in the area for more than 40 minutes, leaving just minutes before the blast took place. No one has so far claimed responsibility for the blast. Government Minister Durya Yanik wrote in a tweet that a government ministry employee and his young daughter were among the victims. There was a heavy police presence around Istiklal Street, which had been cordoned off. Helicopters were circling overhead as ambulances went back and forth. Many shopkeepers standing in their doorways on the normally bustling street looked stunned, adding that the incident will have come as a shock to many in the city. And in the wake of the attack, condolences to Turkey have poured in from around the world. The U.S. said it stood shoulder to shoulder with its NATO ally in countering terrorism, according to a statement from White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre. French President Emmanuel Macron wrote in a tweet in Turkish, "We share your pain. We are with you in the fight against terrorism." Ukrainian President Zelensky, also writing in a tweet in Turkish, said, "The pain of the friendly Turkish people is our pain." Countries including Pakistan, Italy, and Greece also expressed their solidarity. Istiklal Street, one of the city's main arteries, which is usually packed with shoppers, was previously targeted by a suicide bomber in 2016. So prayers go out to all the people who have been affected by that explosion and bombing. Okay, so let's get into some sporting news. What is happening around the world when it comes to sports? Well, of course, when it comes to sports, there's very few places that are really, really that popular. We're going to start off with soccer at the EPL. Only one really big match. It was Manchester United defeating Fulham 2-1 in the Italia Serie A League. Juventus defeats Lazio 3-1. And in France, PSG defeats AJ Auxerre 5-0. So that was a huge game right there. So I hope you guys, if you saw that game, and the 5 different scores too. So that was quite amazing also. In MMA action, I told you about this yesterday. Big, big match and stunning upset as Alex Pereira stuns Israel Adesanya by TKO to claim the UFC title. Alex Pereira had Israel Adesanya's number in kickboxing. He has it in MMA too. So what happened before was, Pereira is the only man to ever knock out Adesanya, stop them again via TKO in 2 minutes and 1 second of the 5th and final round Saturday night in the main event of UFC 281 at Madison Square Garden. With the victory, Pereira won the UFC middleweight title in just his 4th fight with the promotion. Adesanya had been the champion since 2019. Adesanya had been winning the fight until the final sequence, with Pereira firing a barrage of punches with Adesanya hurt against the cage. Referee Mark Goddard stepped in to stop it after a flurry of left hooks and right hands, though Adesanya was never dropped. So big congratulations out there to Pereira. In NHL news, couple games on the slate, and a really sad one for me as the Vancouver Canucks lose to the Boston Bruins 5-2. Now the Canucks, what's their record? It's 4-9-3. They're terrible. They're 6th in the Pacific. I'm not very happy. Also in other news, Dallas beats the Philadelphia Flyers 5-1. The San Jose Sharks defeat the Minnesota Wild 3-2. The New York Rangers defeat the Arizona Coyotes 4-1. The Washington Capitals lose to the Tampa Bay Lightning 6-3. And another Canadian team wins. That is the Winnipeg Jets defeat the Seattle Kraken 3-2 in overtime. So there it is, guys. That is news going on around the world. Hope you guys really enjoyed that. That's news and sports. Kind of gets our hearts in the right place when it comes to what should we pray for when it comes to praying for the world, all right? So now that the sports and world news is done, you know what that means. It is the golden time. yes, it is the golden time, a time of praise and worship to the Holy Trinity. Hope all of you guys are looking forward to giving glory to God and the Holy Spirit. So, what are we going to praise and worship today? We're going to start off with We Are Confident and then His Will, and we'll end things off with Jehovah God. So, as one body of the Morning Star Drive, let's spend this time giving praise, honor, and glory to the Holy Trinity.
Our clock is ticking, the hands of our clock keep on moving, they never stop. Cause we are following the timing of God who is mighty, we don't stop.
I will do the work I must do, I'm the key to the outcome that I want.
It's the truth of the times, we run diligently, we're making history. I trust in the power that God's given. God is with us, supporting us always. We can never lose while we are on this path.
No matter what comes our way, whatever may happen now.
Hey, have you caught our vibe by now?
Sure, what?
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Doesn't matter what may come.
Confident, unshaken.
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Come with me, we'll stand as
we
one.
We're proud, unwavering.
Confident, unshaken.
Confident, now.
We are proud, unwavering.
We are so proud.
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Hey, have you caught a vibe by now?
So what?
No matter what happens, we'll turn tables and we'll climb. Grab the time, fix our minds, fix our contradictions, we will shine. We'll shake it up like sneeze, say God bless you. If there's obstacles to block our way, we'll step right over. Ha, ha. Gain momentum, don't touch it, tremble. Moving forward, just one more step, and now we're going forward. We're following the time, we follow the high. We come together, we're stronger. And like heaven, I am established, firm and shaken. And just like the sun, the will of God is never stopping. Like a backpack, God has my back. He's with me, so I'm safe, I'm so confident. I have dignity, whatever it may be. I'm ready to face with energy, battery charged up. I'm set up with the Lord, I'm confident. We're winning, game, set.
Supporting us always, we can never lose while we are on this path.
No matter what comes our way, whatever may happen now.
Hey, have you caught a vibe by now?
So what?
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Doesn't matter what may come.
Confident, unshaken.
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Come with me, we'll stand as one.
We are proud, unwavering.
Confident, unshaken.
Confident, now.
We are proud, unwavering.
We are so proud.
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Hey, have you caught a vibe by now?
So what?
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Doesn't matter what may come.
Confident, unshaken.
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Come with me, we'll stand as
we
one.
We are proud, unwavering.
Confident, unshaken.
Confident, now.
We are proud, unwavering.
We are so proud.
Confident, we're confident, yeah. Hey, have you caught a vibe by now?
So what?
Yeah, yeah, huh. Since God is with us, we are confident, unshaken. Yeah, yeah, huh. The Holy Spirit is with us, we are proud, unwavering.
Since God is with us, we are confident, unshaken.
The Holy Spirit is with us, we are proud, unwavering. Since we live by God, but do it confidently, confidently, do it confidently.
Hey, have you caught a vibe by now?
So what?
By my side, I believe without a doubt. word. Giving all my life, I've lived according to his word. Look at all he's done in my life, his infinite power.
There is nothing in the world my God can't do. He displays his mighty power through the word.
Jehovah,
mighty God,
mighty God, eternal, mighty God, creator, mighty God, God of the perfect word, he is our mighty God.
And what a great song. That was Jehovah God, and that's one of those new recordings that came out just recently, and singing is amazing on that. I'm really, really grateful and thankful for the team working on this song. Before that was His Will, and of course, We Are Confident. So now that our hearts and our minds are prepared through the time of praise and worship, let's get into today's word study. And of course, today is the practical word study of this week's message of the end is strong. So there are a couple points that I was looking at. Some things are conceptual, and some things I do think that we're able to really put into action, but it does require for us to first change the way that we think about certain things when it comes to the situation we're going through right now, and how is it relevant to this week's message. So one of the big points that I really like is God's progressive effort, right? The more, the deeper he gets into something, the more effort he puts in, so it gets better and better and greater and greater, right? So I think first thing we need to understand the concept of what this means, that progressive effort, the more you get into something, and because the end has to be strong, the most of the energy has to come at the very, very end, okay? So what does this really mean? And I think there's one thing that we do need to correct in our hearts and our minds. Now, as we do something more and more, we do have to realize as things go on, the reason why we slow down is mainly because it gets more and more difficult, right? This is why during the process, a lot of people slow down. A lot of people don't want to do it. A lot of people are like, oh, do I really have to do this, right? So one thing we do need to realize is as we, you know, are in the process of doing something, it gets more and more difficult. Okay, so that's something we know in life is like, yeah, we start off really well because we're really fired up, but then in the middle, it's really, really hard. And that's true because it's getting more difficult. But what does it mean that it's getting more difficult, and what does that mean for us and the effort that we put in? And Sunsi talked about this probably like, I remember like Sunsi talked about this like 15 years ago. And he says, the more difficult something becomes, the more effort you need just to do or maintain what you already have. Right? And the reason I'm saying this is I don't want people to start confusing progressive effort with results. Example is this. If you're walking on flat land and you're walking, say, 5 kilometers per hour, okay, then it's going to take a certain amount of effort for you to walk 5 kilometers per hour. However, imagine it's no longer flat land, but it becomes like a 15-degree incline. Now, if there's a 15-degree incline, what does that mean? It means that to keep walking 5 kilometers per hour, you're going to have to exert that much more energy because you're on an incline. And it doesn't mean that, oh my gosh, you're walking slower than 5 kilometers now. And the answer is, well, if you're on an incline and things are becoming more difficult, you're actually exerting more energy but actually walking slower because you're on an incline, right? And that's something that we have to think about is, God is progressive, and the more he does something, what's happening? The more energy he's putting in, okay? So what we have to realize is we can't connect the amount of effort we're putting in with the result itself as, oh, things are slower than before, so things are not the same, right? There is a huge difference where the effort that we're putting in has to become more and more, partly because it's going to become more difficult, and partly, you know, And because we're physical human beings, we're going to start looking at things in the result format. Like, well, I'm not walking that fast. Things are a lot slower than I thought. And that's okay. We need to realize the concept of what God's talking about here, right? So now that we're putting more effort into keeping, we're putting in more effort to keep it moving. And that's the first thing I want to talk about is that concept, right? Don't connect it to results, right? Just because you're not, you know, in the past you were able to connect 10 people per week for Bible study, it doesn't mean you're doing any less just because there's only five, right? Especially during a pandemic, there's going to be less people that can do Bible study, less people that are outside, right? More effort you got to put in just to find one more person, right? And that's why even when Sunseem is saying that, yeah, it's a big difference when you have a foreigner being evangelized, it's like compared to 10 Koreans, right? Because the effort is less, or effort is more in a foreign country, right? It's more difficult. And this is why we have to kind of, you know, compare eggs to eggs. More than just, oh, I'm not doing the same as I did before. You have to kind of look at more than just the result. You have to look at effort and the situation, the context of the situation that you're in right now. So that's the first thing that I want that everyone to first to change in their minds, right? The second thing I want everyone to realize is the concept of doing things until the end, okay? And one of the things that I really like from the message is the concept of nothing really happens until the end. You won't get the answer until the end. You won't get the result until the end. You can't eat the food until the end. You can't live in the house until the end, right? Everything happens at the end. And it's one of those things where we really feel hopeless at times because nothing's moving. And it's because we're in process. Things are super difficult, right? And a lot of times people lose hope. I put so much energy in. This is happening. Oh my gosh. And then nothing's happening. Oh, I want to give up. I just want to give up. Because at that point, you feel like there's no hope because you're exerting so much energy, yet there is no, there's nothing coming out from the end of it. The hope is in, remember, the hope is the ending, not the middle process, not the things are going out there. And you know you hit the end when you finish everything, right? When, like, say, if you're arguing with your friend, how do you know you hit the end? You hit the end because of what? Because you've got the answer. You hit the end because you were able to resolve the problem. That's why you hit the end, right? You have to find the things, right, that you haven't finished yet, right? And that's the thing that I wanted to figure out. So that now that you look at, now that we understand that nothing happens until the end, don't lose hope. Right? Don't lose hope. Like, look at the things that in your life right now. The first exercise I would do is look at some of the things that you really, really wanted to do, but you kind of gave up in the middle. Some people is about writing journals. Some people is about preparing my first lecture. Some people is about going out just to find one person to connect. Like, there's a lot of different things that we went out to try and do, but we feel like we've just lost hope because nothing's happening from it, right? But we do have to realize is, yeah, things are going to happen, but we will know we hit the end when the prayer gets answered, when the thing, the very thing that we want actually happens, right? So the first thing I would do is look for things in my life that I didn't really finish until the end and try to get something done there. Second thing I would do is if I don't have a lot of things that I've really, you know, like I'm not really interested in finishing anyways, even though I stopped, start something now. Think about it right now. Something really small, easy that will benefit you, like cleaning your room, like vacuuming the floor, right? Things you haven't finished yet, right? Something you want to start new. I would say one of the biggest beneficial things, especially for, I know a lot of people who are struggling, people will gain a lot from writing a diary or a journal. And I say diary or journal because diary is usually like we think about girls when it's a diary, and journals we think more of like it's, you know, guys and girls, right? Writing a journal is something that's very, very healthy for you mentally. A lot of people struggle mentally. And one of the things that people can do to really help themselves out is writing a journal every day, right? Whether it's in the morning, whether it's at night, you write a journal down. What are your thoughts? What's your thought process? What are the feelings you're going through? And this really, really helps out people, right? So I'm saying that, yeah, either find something you haven't finished yet or start something now. And the reason why we'll start is when we finally understand these two concepts I just talked about. One is nothing happens until the end, so don't lose hope because at the end is when the answer comes, and progressive effort, right? Progressive effort is what? Progressive effort is, progressive effort is Yeah, don't link it to results, because sometimes they're not connected. Some things are, but some things are not connected, right? There are very few things, like very, very simple things, like making something, like putting something into something else, and then you have one. And you can, you know, you can count how many you have as your progress, because the more effort you put in, the more you should get done. But in most cases, when things are a little bit more complex, it doesn't work that way, where it's just, you know, when it comes to like resolving issues with people, that's not something that's simple, and it's not like an A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then everything's finished there. It's something that we have to realize that, oh, this is what is going on, right? And if we understand these concepts, it really, really helps us out to, you know, kind of push through and not lose hope, right? The last thing I would do as with these two concepts, especially the last one of all the answers come in the end, so don't lose hope, don't get discouraged, is it should be one of your prayer topics. One of you asking the Holy Spirit to change your heart and mind, to never forget that the answer comes in the end. Like to have that type of mentality, to never lose hope, because it always comes in the end. Look at Sunseem's situation right now. It looks dreadful. But one of the prayer topics we should have to never lose hope, never be discouraged, never get depressed, is remembering it's about the end. In the process, a bunch of stuff can happen, but God will not lose in the end. And I want to give you, if you look at Jesus' story, you might think to yourself, like, if you look at strictly from the physical, Jesus was crucified on the cross. It was like the worst thing that was ever possible. However, in the end, through that, people were saved, which means that whatever happens to Sunseem, what matters is the will of God going to be fulfilled, is the number one thing, which means this. If the salvation of mankind is better off that Sunseem loses his trial, then that's going to be the will, because that's the ultimate goal, which is salvation. If we think very physically, we're just going to think, oh, injustice. How could this happen? God, how could you let this happen? Oh, this is going to be the worst thing. Is providence even real? God, are you even on our side? You start to get discouraged and hopeless because you're only thinking about that single moment. At Jesus' time, he was tried, convicted, and killed. But it was the will at that moment. It was the will. And because of that will, what happens? So many great things. Salvation of mankind happened, and that became the will. In the same way, too, we need to realize when it comes to what is going to happen in this situation with the trial is not about whether he goes, you know, he's guilty or innocent. That's not the issue, right? The issue is, what is God's will? That's the big thing. Is God's will going to be fulfilled? Is a thing that we need to really, really pray about, right? Pray for the trial. Pray for everything to work out according to God's will, right? And that's the thing that we want. So we're not, you know, we don't want to be there in a situation where we only have one answer. And if it doesn't happen the way that we want, then God is not here. No, that's like the wrong, because then in that case, you would look at all these major figures in the Bible and think that God was never with them in the first place too, right? So we need to pray for that mindset. Make it be a prayer topic that you will understand. God, Holy Spirit, never let me forget. Never let me misunderstand that this is not the end. Because in the end, right, you win. In the end, God wins. So I don't want to be disappointed. I don't want to feel discouraged. I don't want to feel hopeless. And this is a thing that we really, really want, right? So those are some of the practical things. Like some of it has to do with conceptual change in our hearts and our minds. But this also has to do with... this prayer topic is, I hope it's something that we can look at and say, oh, this makes a lot more sense than I thought. So I hope that all of us can ask the Holy Spirit to change our hearts and minds, and just so that we'll understand this concept that in the end, God wins, so that we won't get depressed, we won't get discouraged, we won't have doubts in our hearts, but we'll realize that we have to rely everything upon God. Okay, so there's a practical word study for today. I hope it's something that you guys really enjoyed. I hope it's something that does change your heart and your mind, and that you'll be able to understand it much better. Okay, so let's move into the song of choice for today on this Japanese Tuesday. Yes, and on this Japanese Tuesday, I just found a song that has like 524 million views, half a billion views. And this is, I'm not sure if it comes from animation or not. This one's from someone named Daoko and Kenshi Yonezu. And this song is called Fireworks. If anyone knows the songs, please tell me about it. But this one is huge, super popular, half a billion views. Please welcome Daoko and Kenshi Yonezu with Fireworks. And there is a reason why there is 524 million views on this song. Great song, Daoko and Kenshi Yunizu with Fireworks. So if anyone knows where the song comes from, go ahead, leave it in the comments below. We'd love to know where it comes from. Great song. I hope you guys really enjoyed that. And if you have any more recommendations of Japanese songs, go ahead and leave it in the comments below. All right. So that means we're going to get into the final section today of Pravi in the Media. And as Sunseem's trial starts on Friday this week in Korea time, let's get into, I really want to get into what the court system is like in Korea so that a lot of us can understand what is happening. And the more we know, the better it is, right? So let's first off just start generally with what are the courts like in South Korea? So it's much similar to America in some sense at this, like at the top of the judicial branch is a Supreme Court and the Constitutional Court, right? So Supreme Court is like America. They are the highest of the highest courts which make the final decisions. And then the Constitutional Court is a court that deals only with the constitutional amendments or things that people say that is not constitutionally right, which is a bit different than America because in America, Supreme Court does both of those things, okay? So underneath the Supreme and Constitutional Court, you'll have the high courts, district courts, and branch courts. And branch courts are organized under the district courts. So you'll have like high courts, district courts, and then underneath district courts, you'll have branch courts, okay? And of course, in Korea, there are specialized courts. Like one is only for family and administrative issues, right? And then there's one for military service, which, you know, I know America and Canada are very similar to, that is only for crimes that happen in the military, okay? So those are special courts, right? Military. So both defendants and prosecutors can appeal first to the district appellate court and then to the Supreme Court, right? So it goes once and then it goes to the Supreme Court. I know in America, because it's a much bigger, you'll have like appellate court and then you'll have like the Supreme Court of the state, right? And then it can go up to the Supreme Court of the entire nation, which is the highest of the highs, right? But this one is basically you appeal once and then it goes to the Supreme Court. So the Supreme Courts are probably much more busier in Korea too. In the mid-2000s, under the Supreme Court, there were 5 intermediate appellate courts, okay? And in the early 2000s, there was only 3 of them, right? And then one family court. So it's quite interesting. Like, things have changed a little bit, but you kind of get an idea of what the Korean court system is like. And if you look at the establishment of the under the Constitution, right, there is the high courts are in Seoul, Gwangju, and Daegu. Seoul, Gwangju, Daegu are those 3 where the high courts are. And they're hearing the appeals against decisions of lower courts in civil and criminal cases, right? And they could assume jurisdiction over litigation brought against government agencies or civil officials, okay? So courts of first, for most civil and criminal matters are the district courts in Seoul and major provincial cities. And then, of course, you have the family court in Seoul that handles, like, marriage and juvenile cases and other family law matters, right? So that's kind of what the system is looking like. So when you look at judges and the legal administrator in Korea, how does it work? So there's a Supreme Court that has a Chief Justice at the top of the top, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. They are appointed by the president. And it's not just the president chooses. The president chooses with the consent of the National Assembly, right? And then, of course, other justices are appointed by the president upon recommendation of the Chief Justice and consent of the National Assembly. So it's very, very similar to America in that sense too. And then, we don't actually have a Chief Justice. Like, there's going to be, I believe there's like 9 right now. Is it 9? 9 people in the Supreme Court in America. And no one is like the chief, like the one that rules everything and makes all the decisions. Like, that doesn't really happen. But here they do have that, right? However, the Chief Justice, with consultation with other justices of the court, they will appoint lower court justices, which I think is a good idea, because if one person is just appointing, it's just too much power, it could easily be corruptible, right? Or especially in Korea, where you'll have someone who is like, oh, they went to my school, I gotta treat them well. Oh, there's someone in my family. You don't want nepotism and stuff like that working in there. So it's great that it's gonna be something where it's appointed not just by the Chief Justice, but also by other justices of the court. And the Constitutional Court, the head of the Constitutional Court serves until 70 years old, which is which is good, right? And other constitutional court justices serve 6-year renewable terms with mandatory retirement at age of 65. So although judges do not receive lifetime appointments, they cannot be fired for political reasons, which is a great thing, so that they're not trying to appease people so that they can get appointed again, right? So in Korea, there are no jury trials until 2008, right? But when you look at Sun Seem's case, there was no jury because cases that involved offenses punishable by the death penalty, life imprisonment, or imprisonment for more than 1 year are tried by three judges of a district or branch court, and other cases are heard by a single judge. Okay, so that's why I'm not sure how this trial by jury works, but the reason why Sun Seem was held by no jury is because cases that involved death penalty, life imprisonment, or imprisonment more than 1 year. It's either three judges or one judge, okay? And so that's kind of the situation that he was in. And if you want to know how judges are trained, they're trained really professionally. And, you know, one of the toughest education systems in the world, and these judges have to go through this. And if you want to know how tough the judicial education system is there, like, of course, 2 years of courses at the Judicial Research Training Institute, passing the national judicial exam, possession of qualifications as a prosecutor or as an attorney, okay? But how elite, this tiny elite, okay? In 40 years, from 1949 to 1988, only 3,692 people graduated to become a judge. In 1988, right, at the very end of those 40 years, there was only 940 judges, 668 prosecutors, and 1,593 practicing attorneys. That's a really, really small number. Right? And if you want to get high positions, like, you know, you're going to need like anywhere from 5 to 15 years of legal experience. Like, you know, of course, 15 years you need to be the Chief Justice or the Justice of the Supreme Court, right? Obviously, right? Anywhere from 5 to 15 years. So there is a lot of experience that is needed. Personally, I think even 15 years might be a little bit not enough, like in America, because there's more lawyers and such, and the rules are even more. Like, they're more, the legal system is crazy, right? So I think that's another thing that we have to look at too. But the prosecutor, you know, that's kind of what you have to look at, how you become a judge over there, okay? So how does the system work where you can prosecute someone, right? This is a system that we're looking at right now. So the prosecution has to decide whether they want to file an indictment or not with the court and pursue the criminal case, right? So a formal criminal court trial will be set once they say, we're going to go in with this case. So the prosecution is required to submit to the court all relevant evidence that they have gathered in the investigation. The law does not set any timeline for submitting evidence to the court. Okay, so that's why we're having it this Friday, because it looks like the prosecution is ready to indict Sun Seem. All right. Now, it's really interesting how the police and the prosecution work together. And if you look at how they work together, public prosecutors and the police are authorized to conduct investigations of criminal acts, but theoretically, police authority to investigate criminal acts is subject to the direction and review of prosecutors, which is quite interesting because they're separate when it comes to, you know, in America. So the police can do their job without anyone hindering them, and then, you know, the lawyers will just come to them, the prosecutor will just say, hey, what's this? What's going on here, right? So it's quite interesting how it's subject to the review of prosecutors, which I think is quite interesting, right? And the public prosecutor, if they initiate legal action, then like it'll be like the name of the accused, alleged crime, alleged facts of the case, applicable laws are stated in the indictment. And then, of course, the prosecutor has significant discretionary power to decide not to bring the case to court based on his interpretation of the law and evidence or in consideration of a suspect's age, character. So, you know, they can say, no, I don't think it's worth it for us to do it, or this is not the right thing to do, right? But prosecutors have to indict only when they accumulated what they considered overwhelming evidence of a suspect's guilt. It has to be overwhelming, right? And one thing that's really scary here is that the courts in Korea historically are predisposed to accept the allegations of fact in an indictment. What does that mean? The predisposition means that the courts will generally agree with the prosecutors. How much do they agree? Well, the acquittal rate, which means the rate where the courts say this is, you know, we can't go through with this, is less than 0.5%, which means 99.05% are charged, like, or they're going to be indicted, which is quite crazy, right? Especially in criminal cases. So the principle of innocent until proven guilty said in this article applies more in practice to the pre-indictment investigation more than the actual trial. So that's kind of a scary thing there too when you look at how it is in Korea, right? So that's something that we have to take into consideration also. So when we take a look at trials without juries in South Korea, it looks like that's what Sun Seem is going to go through, a trial without jury. Right, because remember, there was no jury system in Korea until 2008. But remember, like we said before, if it has to do with the death penalty, life imprisonment, or imprisonment for not less than 1 year, we're tried by three judges of a district or branch court, or sometimes one court, a single judge. Right, so that's something that we have to look at right now. Is yeah, it's going to go through not a jury trial either. And what happens is 5 days before the trial, defendant served a copy of the indictment. Then the defendant had to be represented by counsel if the offenses were really high, like we said before, death or imprisonment for more than 3 years or life imprisonment, whatever it is, right? So they will get a copy of the indictment. And hearings are generally open to the public, but of course, just like America too and Canada, if it's going to be something that influenced people in the wrong way, then it could be closed too, right? And they are generally open to the public, but if there is a danger, national security or prejudice to public peace or good morals are involved, yeah, it could be closed proceedings too, all right? So either the defendant or the prosecutor could appeal a judgment on the basis of law or fact, and appeals could result in reduced or increased sentences, which happened in the first trial for Sun Seem 2. There was an increased sentence from 6 to 10 years, right? And a constitutional court, you know, that's more for if there's a constitutional matter. Right, and they were established. The Constitutional Court didn't even come into effect until 1988 to relieve the burden of the Supreme Court. And you can see why there's such a big burden on the Supreme Court in Korea, because it only required one appeal and then you go straight to the Supreme Court. Where in America, Supreme Court, like there's a Supreme Court of the state, right? You have to appeal, and then you appeal again, right? And it rarely gets to the Supreme Court of the United States, right? So that's quite interesting too. So. But of course, in Korea, the Supreme Court retains the final power to make final review of the constitutionality or legality of whatever decrees, regulations, actions when it comes to a trial. Okay? So grounds for an appeal to the Supreme Court are limited by the Code of Criminal Procedure to violation of the Constitution, law, or regulation material to the judgment, or like abolition, alteration, pardon of penalty, a grave mistake in fact-finding, extreme impropriety in sentencing, all those types of things, which makes sense, right? And an interpretation of law in an appeal had binding effect on the inferior court only when the case was remanded. So in other cases, however, the decision of the Supreme Court only had persuasive effect. Okay, so let's get into the trial procedures in South Korea. So the first trial, this Friday, is normally held within 2 to 4 weeks of the prosecution filing the indictment. So this is like a month after, right? It's less than a month after Sun Seem was held, right? And you may be detained until the first court appearance of the trial. And if you wish to have access to these documents or believe that information is missing, your lawyer may be able to advise you on the most appropriate options available to you, okay? Now, although bail is not common in the South Korean legal system, you have the right to seek it, right? So it's not common, but you have the right to seek bail. And bail is rarely granted for people who are accused of serious crimes or foreigners charged with felonies. So the bond for bail is usually paid in cash only, and the amount will be set by the court. And you should ask your lawyer about how bail may apply to your circumstances, right? In a criminal trial. Now in South Korea, trials are conducted both in writing and orally, and witnesses give testimony either live during a trial session or in writing submitted to the court. And the lawyers for both sides also present their arguments to the court both orally and in writing by submitting legal briefs. Foreigners are entitled to an interpreter throughout the trial, and if an interpreter has not yet been appointed, you should request one. And in South Korea, for the trial, there are usually several hearings. The trial does not occur in one or two sittings, but in many sessions. And for a foreigner who is charged, you know, which is not Sun Seem 2, you know, that's not really going to worry to us. But the length of time your case is before the court will depend in part on the number of other cases before the court. So since trial dates are generally at least 2 to 3 weeks apart, the case may last for several months. So that's something that we have to we have to have expectation for. It's going to last several months. And if you're not detained during the trial dates are usually 4 weeks apart. And in the event you confess to the crime, the trial is usually limited to one session, right? Which is not going to happen this time too. And a verdict is typically rendered within a month of the final trial date, though it may take longer in some cases. So we're looking at, you know, is not going to be one sitting. We're going to look at multiple sittings for this trial with Sunstein. And on top of it, after the final trial sitting, the final trial day, it's going to take about a month for the final decision to come out. Okay? So here's something that's quite interesting, I think, is reforms of trial procedures in South Korea. And that started in 2007. Right? So, you know, of course, this is one of the good things that has to happen in every country is you need to see what works and what doesn't work. And there are some reforms that started from 2007. Okay, so for the Korean Criminal Procedure Code, they lay out, you know, like they'll change the way the layout of the courtroom is or the way the proceedings were carried out, right? So before this revision 2007, the prosecutor and defense attorney sat facing each other while the defendant was separated from his or her counsel and located in front of the bench facing the judges. This setup implied that the defendant was not an adversarial party equal to prosecutor, and that the defendant was just more an object of the trial. So that's why they changed up more like it is in American law right now. So that's quite interesting, and I think that gives a different feeling when you're watching the court also. Right, so like, there's a bunch of things that do have to change, and we have to look at it too. That there are things that have to change in every court system, and it has to grow with society. Right, so we do know that Korea does have to grow a lot more too. But it's something that, you know, we have to understand the rules and laws of what's happening in this, and we have to be able to be those that understand that. What is happening here is what's happening to Sunstein at this time, right? So I hope it's something that when you look at this, like, oh, okay, this is what is going to happen with Sunstein here. It's going to take several months. We're not sure, maybe four or five, depends how many sittings there are. And if usually 2 to 3 weeks between sittings, which means that it really depends on how busy the courts are. So if it's super busy, he might be getting, like, Sunstein might be getting one trial per month, month and a half, possibly if it's that busy. But we're hoping every 2 to 3 weeks you're going to have a trial. It might go 3, 4, 5, 6, which could lead to like 3, 4 months of constant trial. So there's something we really need to pray for and make sure that whatever happens, that everyone is doing this according to God's will, right? So jury trials, we're not going to really get into jury trials because I don't think Sunstein is going to be a jury trial anyways. And it's something that we can go into a little bit later, but that's kind of what the system is going to be like. Hope you guys really got something out of this, and it helps you to see how this is going to turn out when, or how it's going to happen with Sunstein 2. All right. So there it is, guys. That is the ending of today's Probably in the Media, kind of going through the trial system of how Sunstein is going to go through this. And I hope it's something that you guys can really benefit from. All right. So there it is, guys. Probably in the Media. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Leave a comment below if there's something that helped you guys out. I hope it's something that we can really pray for understanding the system that we're going through. All right. So there it is, guys. That is the last section for this Tuesday podcast. Hope you guys really enjoyed it. And more than anything else, I hope you guys have an amazing and awesome day. And we'll see you guys tomorrow on the Morning Star Drive on 117.8.
It's the Morning Star Drive, 117.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the Morning Star Drive, you know. I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know.